Another new engine, one of the later ones. This is the ET9 or the M15. Comes with 3 spare O-rings for the piston, starting adapter for your cordless drill, instruction sheet, and what has been pretty typical foam packing. This manufacturer continues to package his engines very well. This is a very attractive little engine made to look like a diesel. It is not a diesel engine. It is not a Stirling engine. This is a 4-cycle internal combustion engine. It will run on gasoline or the fuel that I show in one of my videos. Contrary to the website, it will not run on kerosene. It will run on aviation gasoline. This is a fairly complicated little engine. It's got a lot of pieces and gears and bearings in it, and I didn't really understand how it worked myself. So we're going to start with this engine taken apart, and we're going to put it back together and then run it. There are a lot of little fasteners on this engine, and these are all 1.6 millimeter thread. This is a 1.5 millimeter Allen wrench, and that's what these sockets are. The head bolts are 4 millimeter. I have a 4 millimeter socket wrench that fits right on there. And I have a 4 millimeter open end wrench. There are all kinds of these little screws and fasteners. There's a little tiny nut that holds the valve cover on here. If you drop one of those and it goes into the carpet or something, it is gone forever. I put this engine inside of one of these little plastic containers and removed all the screws and that, so if anything decided to go on a trip, it was in here. The castings for these engines get better all the time. This is a nice looking casting. And the head, the valve cover, the water tank, these pipes, these are all castings. Very well done. This is the end of the crankshaft. It's a D section. That gear is either pressed on there or glued on with something like Loctite. I don't see any set screws in that. There's no set screws in these. This one's held on by this C-clip. And this one is pinned. And the only one that has a set screw on it is this one. That tightens onto the shaft. This shaft has the cams for the exhaust and intake valves. And opposite that set screw is a magnet. That magnet is for the Hall effect sensor. There are 8 bearings in this engine. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And 6 is over here on this side of the crankshaft. And then 7 and 8. If I follow this crankshaft across to the other side, I can just catch a glimpse of what looks like a D section that has this flywheel on it. There are no visible set screws or anything in the flywheel. I suspect that they have a set screw going down into a D section, and then that is covered by this drive pulley starting adapter. You use your cordless drill adapter to go in here, and then you can drive something with O-rings off of these V-grids. There are 6 gears. This gear is on the crankshaft, and in terms of the timing for the valves, this is an idler. This has 18 teeth and this has 36. That's a 2-to-1 reduction for a 4-cycle engine. This gear drives a counterbalance. And this is running this reversing gear, and it drives another counterbalance. The piston is at bottom dead center. This is the lower end of the connecting rod. And these 2 flat surfaces are the backside of 2 rotating counterbalances. With the piston at top dead center, we can now see the curvature of those 2 weights. And they swing in unison and swing opposite to the travel of the piston. So the piston is coming down, those weights are swinging forward, the piston is going up, and these weights are swinging back. A single cylinder engine is subject to the cyclic vibrations caused by the rotation of the crankshaft and the traveling of the piston and the connecting rod. And you add the explosion of combustion, which is simultaneously trying to blow the head off and drive the piston back through the connecting rod. And that's where you get your vibration. And we see that cyclic change from the occasional firing on the hit and miss engines when the engine is jumping all over the table. And these vibrations are most noticeable on a single cylinder engine. Single cylinder engines are virtually impossible to balance perfectly. And as the number of cylinders increase, then those cyclic vibrations offset or cancel each other out. And you start getting into engines that run much more smoothly. And the increase in number of cylinders or even number of cylinders, generally you will not see a 3, 5, or 7 cylinder engine. It will be 1, 2, 4, 6, 8, so forth. The addition of the spinning counterbalances attempts to offset the inertial forces and allows the improvement or refinement of a multiple cylinder engine. The mass of these counterbalances are moving opposite to the movement of the piston and connecting rod. They are in the same direction as the counterweights on the crankshaft. This is the cover plate for the gears, and it contains this little locking lever for the carburetor setting. This all appears to be castings. The cover plate is CNC machined. A nice little cover plate, very attractive. And this is a clever little locking mechanism. This works quite well. So it'll be interesting when we fire this up to see just how smoothly it runs. They have put a lot of time and effort into the development of this engine. To replace an O-ring piston ring, you take the valve cover off so you can get to these 4 bolts. And take those off, take the spark plug wire off, and then the head will come off. But that will not expose the O-ring on that piston. The top of the piston will stop about here. So then you have to come back here, take the bottom end off of the connecting rod, rotate that forward, and get the crankshaft out of the way and take something that will not scratch that connecting rod and push it forward until the piston comes out altogether or sticks out far enough to where you can replace the O-ring. Then you reverse the process and put it back together again. I would advise removing this cover plate and putting a little oil on these gears. You don't have to worry too much about the bearings. They're permanently sealed. Put a little bit behind this gear. I don't see a bearing behind there. Put a little bit on this bushing on the lower end of the connecting rod and turn that out of the way and turn the engine on N. Drip a little oil in there for the upper end that's inside the piston. And I can't show it on camera. This shaft is driving 2 very small cams. And then there's cam followers. Drip some oil down in there. Put some oil on the ends of these push rods and on this shaft for the rockers, here on the tappets and on the springs. And that should take care of the lubrication. When you replace the valve cover, this nut and the one over here will have to be turned so that the flap will clear the edge of that valve cover. That's kind of unfortunate, and it may keep you from getting these as tight as you want it. If that's the case, you could put a little washer underneath here, and that would help with that timing. You don't want to over-tighten these. You don't want to over-tighten any of these, but you do need it to be snug, at least tight enough to where that head gasket doesn't leak. We have the on-off switch, and this requires 3 AA penlight batteries. This little mechanism, this works pretty well. You can position the carburetor where you want it. This is wide open, this is idle. You put it somewhere in between. If that's the speed you want, you can gently tighten that down. That will hold that carburetor in that position. And I'm not really sure what the function of this is other than looks. On some of these old engines, you used to be able to put a hand crank in here and it had a one-way cranking mechanism. You could release the compression and start spinning this thing, then hit the compression and the engine would take off. I think that's supposed to look like that. As far as I can tell, it has no function for this engine. When you're putting these little screws in, I have a video on timing threads. You put that in there with your Allen wrench. You want to turn it backwards until you hear that thread click, and then you can screw it in. It'd be real easy to cross thread these small fasteners. Have water and fuel. You'll have to take the top off of this and hold your finger over the carburetor to choke it. I've already done that, but that'll get you fuel from the gas tank to the carburetor very quickly. It's a very smooth running engine. It does not dance around. The main vibration here is because it's on top of this tarpaulin. You can hear that gear noise. It sounds a little bit like a turbo. Very smooth, very, very nice running little engine.